Christ. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 400. Good morning. This is our first in-person service that we've had since March. I welcome everyone that's watching online. And this is our Sunday, September 13th morning prayer service. Next week we will have our Deacon's Mass. So as being our first in-person service, we are trying out music again. And so please bear with us. We don't have a rousing course. so we'll do as we best we can. So those of you that do have the Book of Common Prayer, we are starting on page 79. And let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. The mercy of the Lord is everlasting. Come, let us adore him. For those of you that do have the Book of Common Prayer, on page 82, we'll say the Jubilate together. Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age. And now we'll have, you can be seated. We're going to have a reading from Psalm 114. Thanks be to God. We are working out some technical difficulties. We're going to get the mic turned.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The angel of God who was going before the Israelite army moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." And then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. And as the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and their chariot drivers. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, and the waters forming a wall before them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great work that the Lord did against the Egyptians. And so the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and his servant Moses. The word of the Lord. On page 90, let us say a song of praise together. Glory to you, Lord God of our fathers. You are worthy of praise. Glory to you. Glory to you for the radiance of your holy name. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. Glory to you in the splendor of your temple, on the throne of your majesty. Glory to you. Glory to you seated between cherubim. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. Glory to you beholding the depths in the high vault of heaven. Glory to you. Glory to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then, each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, You take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him his debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. And then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgive you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave, as I had mercy on you? And in anger, the Lord handed him over to be tortured until he could pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Last Sunday, we heard how the early church recommended approaches to another member who sins against you. Now we see the message of forgiveness. Jesus on the cross prayed that his enemies might be forgiven and forgave them while they were still intent on his death. This is a parable and not an allegory, and we read it for what it is. It illustrates the principle of the Lord's Prayer. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. It highlights one of the most important aspects of Christ's teachings, forgiveness. God is always willing to forgive, but can't enter an unforgiving heart. The debt in our gospel reading was basically a loan that was owed. Folks often ask me what the value of a talent is. That's the equivalent to an ounce of gold. So, 10,000 talents would be worth about $14 million today. And the purchasing power of $14 million was greater back then than it is today. It would be almost impossible to repay. The servant in the parable was probably a government official who sought to gain from his office and in some way was caught up short. Josephus, a first century Roman Jewish historian, tells of a certain Joseph who heard that 8,000 talents was being bid for certain taxing rights, and then Joseph countered that bid with a bid of 16,000 talents. Now, if someone like that would find himself unable to pay what he bid, he would be caught in precisely the situation described in the parable. He may have bid foolishly high, or perhaps a drought or economic depression collapsed his revenue. But in any case, he didn't have the money that he owed. The 100 denarii in our gospel reading was the equivalent of $20. The offense, you know, that this second person was so trivial compared to the crime that was put upon Jesus when he was on the cross, and he forgave so freely. We can find forgiveness throughout the New Testament. In Matthew 6, Jesus says, "For if you forgive men what they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins." In Mark 11, Jesus says, "And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you of your sins." And even Paul in Galatians writes, "Bear with each other, forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another, forgive as the Lord forgave you." Now, Jesus wanted his disciples, and now for us, to understand the sense of trespassing into territory that doesn't belong to us. Now, you can imagine in Jesus' audience clearly understood how people were thrown into debtors' prisons. Today, we have bankruptcy laws that protect us in ways that were unheard of back then. You know, trespassing hits us differently. A trespasser violates another person. And this can be damaging. You know, there's a book on the website christianbook.com by Father Eamon Tobin, How to Forgive Yourself and Others. And he talks about the steps to reconciliation that fits perfectly in this morning's passage on forgiveness. Now, remember that forgiveness is God's way of dealing with life's hurts. Revenge or deliberately deciding not to give is the world's way. So when we pray for the grace to forgive and do all that we can to forgive, we're acting like true disciples of Jesus. Also, when we, through the grace of God, can let go of a hurt done to us, we're choosing to control the hurt instead of letting it control us. I'm sure we've all been there, wanting to hang on to that hurt until we're ready to let go. It's difficult. Remember that forgiveness, especially a sizable hurt, only happens when we truly desire it, while recognizing the major role that God's grace plays in that process. It takes a good deal of humility, not a very popular virtue these days, for us who are raised in self-sufficient culture to admit that we can't do something. You know, it's one of the utmost importance to come to the realization with terms of our own powerlessness to forgive hurts and our need to look to God to help us. Remember, often, the reason for failure of our efforts to forgive is because we don't want to forgive, which is very understandable when we have sizable hurts. On the surface, we think we want to forgive, but deep down, we're not really ready. Needless to say, we can pray all day for God to forgive us, but if we don't want to forgive, then our prayer might be in vain. Remember that forgiveness of a hurt takes time and patience. We live in a society where we're used to getting quick results, but to heal the heart of an extensive hurt, we must prepare ourselves for a slow process. We must be ready and willing to pray and talk about the hurt over and over so that it can be healed. To pray a few times and expect that everything is going to be okay is simply unrealistic. Remember, there's a difference between forgiveness of a hurt and the healing of a hurt. Sometimes we may feel ill at ease because we still harbor negative feelings that indicate We don't want to forgive in our heart. That hurt has been forgiven, but the wound has festered because the betrayal hasn't been healed. The point here is that we shouldn't necessarily conclude that we haven't forgiven someone just because we still feel hurt and negative about what's happened. Forgiveness is primarily an act of the will and not a matter of feelings. If our negative feelings lead us to behave in a negative way, then we have the very reason to believe that complete forgiveness has not taken place. Remember, there's a difference between forgiveness and the reconciliation of a heart. We can, with the grace of God, always forgive the hurt, but we can't always reconcile a relationship. We can always forgive sin for an offense that a person has committed against us, but we can't always restore the relationship because the other person just might not be interested. You know, it only takes one person to forgive, but it takes two to reconcile a hurt. Remember, we might need a good counselor to help us walk through the hurt and let go of those hurts that may happen in our lives. A counselor will help us get in touch with our pain and any possible denial of its existence. A counselor will also remind us that anger towards those who hurt us, it's legitimate. You know, and finally, a counselor will remind us to express our feelings while we pray, and at the same time, asking for God's healing. Remember that before we begin to pray about the hurt, we need to make sure that we take the time to own and express any feelings connected with that hurt. It's crucial in the forgiving process. Of course, it's not going to be easy for us if we've been taught not to express our feelings. I know I grew up that way, you know, or led on that, well, our feelings aren't as strong as they really are. So we just say, oh, we're a little upset, when in fact, we're really angry. So the good news is that through the grace of God, we're already been forgiven from our own faults and our own failures. An unforgiving heart produces nothing but pain in either the offended, the offender, or even both. So forgiveness frees us from hatred and restores us to a loving relationship with God as well as our fellow person. I'm reminded of a saying in the classic film of Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure: be kind to one another. Well, we can go a step further. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ, God forgave you. Amen. On page 96, we will say the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Suffrage A, show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. Today's collect, O God, because of without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may be in all things, direct and rule our hearts through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A collect for Sundays. O God, you make us glad with a weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. A collect for peace. O God, the author of peace and lover of concord, to know you is eternal life, to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your humble servants, in all the assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries through the might of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. A collect for grace. Lord God, almighty and everlasting Father, you have brought us in safety to this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin, nor be overcome by adversity. And in all we do, direct us the fulfilling of your purpose through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A collect for guidance. Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have our being. We humbly pray you, so to guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that in all the cares and occupations of our life, we may not forget you, but may remember that we are ever walking in your sight through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are too far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your Spirit upon all flesh and hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray for the church, for the unity of the Anglican Communion and the Episcopal Church. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of South America. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we give thanks for St. Matthew's Universal City and St. Francis San Antonio. We pray for our presiding Bishop Michael, our Bishop David, our Deacon Dexter, our diocesan seminarians, our President Donald, and our Governor Greg. We ask for strength and healing for Allison, Tom, Joyce, Mary, Clark, Susie, Irene, Isabel, Karen, Anne, Rosalinda, Faye, Alberta, Ty, and for the Surrette family in their bereavement for the life and memory of Sarah. We pray for our military both at home and abroad, but especially for Haley, Abram, Victor, Nathan, and Chasen. And we pray for persecuted Christians everywhere, especially in Nigeria, Sudan, Syria, Egypt, Iraq, Kenya, and Sri Lanka. And we pray for outreach ministries, Divine Food Pantry, Divine Hospice, Hank, Southwest Family Life Center, our military ministry, and Mission Divine. Almighty God, who has promised to hear the petitions of those who ask in thy Son's name, we beseech thee mercifully to incline thy ear to us who have now made our prayers and supplications unto thee, and grant that those things which we have asked faithfully according to thy will may be obtained effectively to relief of our necessity and to the setting forth of thy glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Peace. You can sit down. I want to thank our special guests that are here today, you know, in service. I really appreciate having someone in the pews. And I want to thank everyone who joins us every week for our worship services. I think we're up to about 120 people that watch us online through our different platforms. And it's because of you that we've been able to improve our audio, visual equipment, just to bring you a better experience. Now, I do want to say hello to Renata in Germany, Alex in Slovakia, and Pat in New York, who are watching us this service. Now, we're trying really hard to engage everyone, if you can't be here, to engage you online. And we want to help you any way that we can. So, if you're watching, you can leave online comments, you can leave questions, and you can even leave online prayer requests. And for those of you that are watching at home, please be sure to like our page, or if you're on the YouTube, to like, subscribe to our free YouTube. So that way, when we're getting ready for a service, you can be reminded that a service is coming up. So walk in love as Christ loved us and gave of himself an offering and sacrifice to God. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. On page 101, we will be saying the general thanksgiving together. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your measurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting in this world knowledge of your truth and the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our closing hymn is hymn number 376. modern technology is so interesting when you're trying to do something we haven't done for 6 months. Meg, it's okay if it's not working. Meg? Well, I don't want to keep everyone waiting, so I'll go ahead and do our dismissal. And we will get better as we do more and more in-person services. So, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.